This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised.
I'm in Maine now! Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond Act Studios here, coming to you from my vacation in Maine, where the water's clear, the sky is blue, and I'm ready to talk about Pop 92. Don't bother trying to incinerate me for that. I'm in a different location. It's not gonna work. I said at the beginning of my worst list that the pop scene of 1992 was the scene of a revolution, and the more I think about it, the more accurate that statement feels. After about 5 years of the 80s dying a pathetic, painful, and excruciatingly long death, 1992 was the year that the general public decided it was time for the next decade to start already, and the resulting arms race to decide what would be the next dominant genre in American music sent a lightning bolt of energy through the charts. The best songs of 1992 aren't just a glorious blend of hip-hop, R&B, grunge, new jack swing, ballads, weird experimental shit, and every type of rock that you can imagine, but each genre hits the ground running with some of their most iconic tracks of all time, as they try to prove why they deserve to be the definitive musical trend of the 90s. Which genre won? Well, that's not a call for me to make, but I will gladly recognize the MVPs as we count down. You got to live and learn. I've noticed that suckers will eat up just about any song in the world as long as it has a good bass line. Ever since Castle on the Hill blew everybody away last year, I think it's kind of dawned on everybody just how much they miss U2 in the pop world. I'll admit that I don't know a ton about the band, but I've listened to a good number of their singles, and even a cursory glance will tell you that this is one of the most dynamic bands ever to hit the mainstream. After producing some of the greatest power ballads of the late 80s and some decent, if overwrought, rock tributes at the turn of the decade, 1992 shows a more forward-thinking U2 trying their hand at a funky alt-rock, which they succeed at handily. Mysterious Ways has survived the test of time as a classic funk rock track for fairly obvious reasons. Hear that bass line once and it won't ever leave your head until the day you die. Actually, upon looking into it, it seems like U2 knew that the bass line was something special the moment they heard it. Apparently they were just jamming one day when bassist Adam Clayton came up with the bass line and immediately scrapped everything else from the session and built the song up from that bass line. And to be honest, the reason that this song is only at number 10 is because that kinda shows. The bass line is an all-time classic, but it's not even under the entire track, and the melody that winds around it is nothing to write home about, being pretty simple and not that engaging outside of the chorus. On top of that, the lyrics were clearly an afterthought, as they consist of various literary and biblical references slammed together without much cohesion. I guess they tie into the theme of not hiding from your feelings, but if you ask me, they might have overdone it with the metaphors a bit. Yeah, sorry Mr. Bono, but the moon actually doesn't produce its own light, it's just a reflection of the sun's light, so if you took it out of the sky and took a walk with it, that would kind of make it lose its giant sky mirror properties. Isn't that right, Jesse?
Yes, science!
Is it working?
Am I kissing it yet?
Wait, what?
Keep it in the closet.
Yeah, I'm not even gonna touch that one. Ah, well, not all songs need to be perfect. Sometimes one awesome element can carry a song, and the bottom half of Mysterious Ways more than makes up for anything going on up top. Live long and prosper, you too. May your influence not soon be forgotten. I joked before about not knowing which musical genre won the war for cultural dominance in the 90s, but I think we all know who the winner really was. After mild dabbling in the first 2 years of the 90s, 1992 was the year that hip-hop exploded into the mainstream of the United States. By the year's end, it wasn't just a niche anymore. It was a full-on cultural tidal wave that permanently changed the direction of American music. As bizarre as it might seem today, when hip-hop has become far and away the most ubiquitous genre in American music, the people of the early 90s needed to be slowly acclimated to this new style of music over a few years before actual gangster rap started to chart. Keep in mind, this was the same public that made this one of the biggest hits of the year. Yeah, they weren't about to turn around and listen to this. Nah, clearly there needed to be a transition period where the American public got comfortable with the idea of hip-hop before they got into the realer stuff. So, what was the key to presenting middle America with hip-hop that was a bit less threatening? Have it be performed by middle schoolers. That's what it takes. When you consider the cultural position of hip-hop in the 90s, it's really kind of astonishing that a hip-hop track was the third biggest song of the year. Keep in mind, this is the same year that the Ice Cube pen track Cop Killer set off a media firestorm that turned rap into a dirty word that was emblematic of the moral decay of the United States. There was no way that America was gonna take sides in a beef between Tupac and Biggie yet. So instead, the hottest feud of the year was between Criss Cross and another bad creation. And the war was fought not over turf, but over whether it was cooler to wear your clothes inside out or backwards. And everything is to the back with a little slack, cause inside out is wiggity 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 whack. So, yeah, this song is an important piece in the grand legacy of hip-hop in America, but that alone wouldn't be enough to put it on the list if it didn't hold up. And the fact that it does is kind of astounding. All you have to do is look at turn-of-the-decade Justin Bieber to see just how insufferable child performers can be if they don't have the talent to back up their swagger. Whatever you want, shawty, I'll give it to you. I swear, no matter how old I get, every time I hear that kid use the word shorty, I just want to crumple him up into a football and kick a field goal with him. Fortunately for Criss and Cross here, this song is held up because not only is the beat hot as hell, but these kids actually have legitimate charisma and skill. The best comparison I can think of for this song is Bounce With Me by Lil Bow Wow, which is basically the crunk version of this song, not the least of which because they have the same producer. Both of these songs work not just because of the impressive flows and the hot beat, but because they wear an attitude which I think is perfect for little kids getting into hip-hop. That being, I'm so cool now, so just imagine what I'm gonna be like when I'm actually grown. Where I fit in, braided up, paid the bus, and I'm still a kid. Imagine what life's like when I get big. I'ma be rich, surrounded by chicks. Two good kids with a float you ain't never heard. Ain't nothing fake, you can understand every word. Couple of cars, couple of cribs, getting a couple meals, shining every time I feel. Some of them try to run, but they can't run like this. It strikes a good balance between confidence and a lust to prove themselves that gives the song just enough of an edge to make you root for these kids. Unlike the 14-year-old sex prince of Canada over here. Let me show you what you're missing. Paradise. Is it weird that I'm getting nostalgic for the days when music was actually fun to hate? Blech. Come on, Mac, tell this guy what he is. Couldn't have said it better myself, buddy. Despite what my worst list may have suggested, I want to clarify that I don't hate softer music on principle. Just like any genre of music, there's a lot to love if you look in the right places, and some of my favorite music of all time is soft rock. Just look at how many times I've actively endorsed Wonderful Tonight by Eric Clapton, and that song's not even that good. So, no, I don't hate music with a low tempo. And it just so happens that, by sheer coincidence, my next two songs on this list are both songs that could reasonably be described as easy listening. Number 8 is definitely the less interesting of the two of them, but sometimes you don't need intrigue to carry a song. Sometimes all a song needs to succeed is sheer vocal talent. Let me state for the record that I'm perfectly aware that by putting this song on here, I might look like a bit of a hypocrite. I know that I spent probably a collective half hour of my worst list complaining about how so much of 1992 took no musical risk in terms of production. I know that this song is basically indistinguishable from about a third of Mariah Carey's entire discography. I know that my single biggest complaint about all the adult contemporary of 1992 was how cliched and overdone the lyrics were, and I know that this is quite possibly the most underwritten, predictable, and basic song that Mariah Carey has ever put out. But I'm sorry, listen to it. After sitting through ballad after ballad that tried and failed to do exactly what Mariah is doing here, I can't tell you how much of a breath of fresh air it is to hear a voice with so much effortless passion, emotion, and charisma, and an instrumental that manages to convey the gravity of her emotions without being overdone, and a melody that's neither too basic nor too complex. Mariah takes the simplicity of this song and essentially uses it as a free pass to show off her musical abilities as much as possible before crossing the finish line. Let's just look at the bridge for an example. The last line of the bridge is, "I try and try to deny that I need you, but still you remain on my mind." Seems like a line that's almost insultingly simple, right? Yeah, well, listen to how Mariah delivers this line. Absolutely beautiful. Never before in my life have I heard an artist who's able to release essentially the same song for 20 years straight and make it beautiful in a new way each time. Even when her songs aren't good, she always is, every single time. Except for Loverboy. And Obsessed. And Touch My Body. And that time last year, she released a comeback featuring the guy who made My Nick. You know what, actually, maybe Mariah should stick to releasing the same song over and over again. Whenever she does something interesting enough for people to notice it, that's usually not a good thing. To be honest, I don't know if this is actually one of the best songs of 1992, but have you ever liked the idea of something so much that you convince yourself that you like it, regardless of how good it actually it is? Yeah, that. My mother came to Hazard when I was just 7. Even then, the full This is the other softer song on this list, and it comes to us courtesy of Richard Marx, who I can only describe as Bryan Adams done as right as possible. He was one of the most successful soft rockers of the era, but basically his only song that anybody remembers nowadays is a song that I swear was only written because Every Breath You Take proved that there was a surprisingly large market for love songs that are secretly about stalkers.
Wherever you go, whatever you do, I will be right here waiting for you.
However, why listen to such an unintentionally creepy song when you can listen to a song that's creepy entirely by design? Unlike the rest of Marx's music, or really any other soft rock song at the time, Hazard's production, while still by the numbers to a degree, sets an eerie atmosphere that perfectly sets the stage for the story told by the song. You heard me right. This song actually tells a story, and not just any story, but a murder mystery.
I swear I left a
It tells the tale of a boy who is seen as strange and unsettling to the townspeople of Hazard, the small town that his mother moves to, and he's shunned by the entire village except for a girl called Mary, who is, in his own words, the only one who looked beyond the rumors and lies and saw the man inside. However, when Mary mysteriously disappears, the boy is immediately the primary suspect, and he ends up fleeing Hazard after a brush with the law. Now, at face value, this seems like a pretty open and shut story. Boy meets girl, girl gets killed, boy skips town.
Tale as old as time.
However, what makes this song so fascinating, and what single-handedly got to the spot this high on the list, is that, despite the narrator's insistence that he's innocent, that's actually not entirely clear. Because, think about it. We're only hearing the story from the narrator's point of view. I know that as the narrator, our instinct is to sympathize with him, but listen to this line and tell me that this doesn't sound like it could be at least a bit malicious.
No one understood what I felt for Mary. No one cared until the night you went out walking alone and never came home.
There are little seeds of doubt like that sown all throughout the song that really get you thinking about the whole thing. For example, what exactly is it that causes the townspeople to distrust this kid? The only details we get is that he says he's, quote, not right, unquote. And this is because of prejudice. However, because the lyrics are so vague, we don't have any idea why they think that. It could be anything, from the kid having a lazy eye to him having used a giant death snake to paralyze a cat and hang it from the rafters. We just don't know. I know that you could argue that that's bad writing, but what it means in practice is that every listen of this song provides a new listening experience in a way that you really don't usually get in a pop song. You can listen to Hazard as a song about a kid unfairly blamed for the murder of the only person in town who understands him, a song about a deviant psychopath trying to hide his crimes while toying with the listener's sympathy, or some combination of the two, and it would still be a completely cohesive listening experience. This phenomenon is only heightened by the music video, which provides all sorts of conflicting clues and puzzle pieces that evolve Hazard from a song into one of the most interesting music-based media experiences I've had since This Is America. Of course, being a music video from the early 90s, it should go without saying that some of the elements of this video are, let's say, unintentionally hilarious.
She made you jealous, didn't she?
All right, sure. What's the point?
This is the point. You recognize this? How did you tie this around Miss Mary's neck?
Now, I've personally never tied a scarf around someone's neck with the intention of murdering them, but if I were to do that, I imagine it would go a little something like this.
Why do I keep agreeing to be in these videos?
Oh, jeez.
Oh, my God.
About my life gone by, how it's done me wrong.
To be honest, if you chose to take this song as just another boring Bryan Adams-style soft rock track, I wouldn't blame you for that. However, for me, this song provides a new and intriguing experience with each listen, and if that's not the hallmark of a great song, I don't know what is. Isn't that right, Mr. Marx?
An idea came to me, and I started to work on it. It's this song about a little town in Nebraska, and the more I worked on it, the more I knew that it sucked. thought it was the dumbest thing I'd ever tried to write. This is like the worst Twin Peaks episode ever. I said, I'm not going to do anything with it or record it, anything. And my wife said, babe, that is a huge hit song. And so I'm actually admitting to you guys now that the only reason I recorded this song at all was to prove her wrong.
Ha ha! You may have noticed that several songs on my worst list were the product of sampling, and while I did criticize how the samples were used or integrated, I didn't berate the sampling for being lazy, even though pretty much all of it was. That's because, for the first 15 to 20 years of hip-hop's existence, you'd be hard-pressed to find a song that wasn't based on the sample. During that time, it was simply a part of the genre, so I'm far more lenient towards lazy sampling from back then than I am when, say, Juice WRLD does it today, when the tools to make original beats are more available than ever before. If you ask me, as long as they're able to make a hot song out of it, I'm not gonna give these songs flack for their sampling if their only crime is being derivative. Case in point. And here we have the first song I've ever talked about that does not have its own Wikipedia page. This ought to be interesting. Well, at least I could still look into the group by taking a quick trip over to their MySpace page. Okay then, good old-fashioned digital elbow grease it is. Really making me work for it, this one is. This is In Too Deep, a Chicano hip-hop group from near San Francisco who had their only hit in 1992 with Back to the Hotel. They're not a very well-remembered group nowadays, but their name still holds a lot of weight in certain circles. And that's including mine, because their one and only top 20 hit is an absolute delight. However, I'll be the first to admit that that is not because of the rapping, which really doesn't ascend beyond the level of alright. Lyrics-wise, this song is perfectly passable, just a typical gangster rap song about hopping from hotel to hotel picking up girls. However, the flow feels a bit stilted, which is acceptable considering the time period, but considering the contemporaneous acts like Arrested Development and even Crisscross were starting to standardize the more organic flows, it's still a bit of a letdown. On top of that, these guys don't sound quite as cool as they probably think they do, as they talk about all the girls they get in a nasal tone that distinctly reminds me of another Latin hip-hop act of the era. So hit the light, man, I just might, man, try and throw this thing all night and
there's not a woman that can handle a man like me, that's why I juggle two or three. I ain't wanna commit, you can omit that bit.
However, the reason I'm spending so much time complaining about these minor things is because there's really only one reason that this song is up so high, and that should be pretty obvious by this point. This riff is absolute perfection. The horn line mixed with that percolating bass perfectly conveys the mood of prowling through the dead of night from one hotel to the next. I've heard people say that they've fallen in love with songs the instant they heard them before, but literally, all I had to do was listen to the first couple seconds of this song, and I knew that it would be making this list. Never before have I heard a riff so accurately convey the feeling that the song is trying to get across, which is even more impressive when you consider that this horn line from the Lafayette Afro Rock Band is one of the most popular samples in all of hip-hop. In fact, it was also used in one of the biggest hits of 1993. All I wanna do is zoom, 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 and a boom, boom. And I'll be honest, I think I like it in Back to the Hotel even more than in Rumshaker. Not just because of the added bass, courtesy of the Gap Band, but because of how eerie and brooding it is. One thing that almost all hip-hop on the 1992 charts had in common was that it was fun, upbeat, and happy. And that includes the legit stuff from Arrested Development. Back to the Hotel was just the right swath of darkness that the charts needed, and even if it is riding the crest of the sample, it still deserves this spot, right outside the top half of the list. To find out what songs made it into the top 5, stay tuned for part 2, coming out soon. I'm Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond X Studios, those guys are heading back to the hotel, and I'm heading back to Rhode Island. See you next time.